Hey everyone, Ryan Young, Kama Jiu-Jitsu. I hope you're doing well. It's a pretty nice day out here in late July 2021. I'm sitting right outside of our Flower Mound studio. Thought I'd talk to you guys. And actually, I thought I'd answer a question. So this question came in response to BJJ School has no plan for you. Take control of your Jiu-Jitsu and perfect your techniques. So this was from Roland Code, R-O-L-L-I-N Code, C-O-D-E. And I guess he says, how to focus. Figure out what the key principles are. Find the zeros and base. Establish your zeros and the base and the parameters. And then you start evolving and playing inside the parameters, i.e., what do I have to do to protect myself from all chokes, arm bars, and attacks? How can I survive exactly? And next, how can I move efficiently? How can I breathe? And then we can focus on offense. How can I kazushi or off balance and then set up an attack or sweep? Are there better questions to ask and focus on? Whew, that's a lot there, huh? All right, so first of all, let me kind of just let you know that, to me at least, it's a lot easier than that. How to focus on yourself to make yourself better if your school just kind of teaches randomly. Like I've said so many times, you need a curriculum to follow. If your school doesn't have a curriculum, seek a curriculum that you like and are comfortable learning and that you want to learn. Kama Jiu-Jitsu Online, for instance. We also have our apps on the App Store and on the Google Play Store. Anyway, that was my quick little sale mention there. But regardless, there are other curriculums that are out there right now. You can find them online. I think you've got BJJ Fanatics. Henzo's got his. I can't remember what it's called anymore. Hickson's got his online as well. And you can check any one of those. Here's an important concept now. Whatever curriculum you choose, use it and stick to it. Try not to outsmart it. These are all people who are very successful in what they do as far as jiu-jitsu goes. It makes sense for you to just choose one path and just follow it all the way through. Hopefully they have a methodology in which you can learn it, meaning you have the curriculum, then you need your methodology. Once you have a curriculum, the methodology tells you how do you learn it, in what order do you learn it, which concepts do you cover first, right? So for instance, with Kama Jiu-Jitsu, we have our curriculum, which is Hicks and Gracie Jiu-Jitsu. Then we have everything set up in belts, white to blue, blue to purple, purple to brown. And then within each belt, we have, for the white to blue, we have our self-defense curriculum, and we have it grouped. Headlocks, bear hugs, grabs, distance closing, punch blocking, all that kind of stuff. And then for the groundwork, we have modules 1 through 6. Modules 1 through 6, module number 1 will cover your mount class escapes. So anything that's mount related, worst position, mount, side mounts, seat belt. And then module 2 will cover your cross side class escapes. Cross side 1, cross side 2, knee on belly, north, south, Kesa, modified Kesa. The next module 3 will cover guard passes. Module 4 covers playing guard. Module 5 covers cross side class on top. Playing cross side 1, cross side 2, knee on belly, Kesa, modified Kesa, north south. And the final module, module 6, is top mount class. Playing mount, playing side mount, playing seat belt, playing worst position from the offensive side. Now the defensive side, what we call the red ladder, it tells you all you need to know to get out. Now, is it super detailed? No. The reason is because we need to introduce these concepts to you. We need to get your body used to moving in general terms. We don't go over too many fine details in white to blue. The reason is because if we worry about the trees, you never see the forest. So the first thing we need to do is show you the forest. Then we can go into the individual trees. And then we can go into the little organisms, animals, and all that. As you know, that's you drill down into the details as you progress in belt. So to give an example, the blue to purple curriculum will have module 1, which would be mount class escapes, right? Worst position, seat belt, side mount, and mount. And we'll go over it. You will go over deeper concepts on how to get out of the what ifs. What if your opponent does this? What if your opponent does that? So you understand everything that you had to learn in the white belt section, but now we'll go into the blue belt section. So with Roland Code's plan here, it's very scientific. It's very To me, in my simple thinking, my simple mind, it's very complicated. My goal is to make jiu-jitsu as simple for you as possible. The simpler we make it, the easier it is to learn it, right? I've mentioned this before in other videos. The old saying, how do you eat an elephant? One bite at a time. You can't look at the entire elephant and say, okay, I'm gonna eat this elephant. And then you start to think, wow, you know, this thing is just so huge. And that's really the scope of jiu-jitsu. The scope of jiu-jitsu is massive. In our curriculum alone, Dave has identified 472 concepts and techniques and philosophies that was taught to him by Grandmaster Hickson. Can you imagine how long it would take to learn all that? Now, if I just gave you all 472 concepts, how would you go about tackling it? It needs to be ordered for you. It needs to be put into a system that you can learn in bite-sized pieces. Now, he's got the idea here, defense first, defense before offense, which is exactly correct. But when it comes to how can I protect myself from all chokes, you're not going to be able to protect yourself from all chokes. What you can do is you can learn to protect yourself against most chokes to start off with, right? There are certain concepts that we cover in our modules that enable you to deal with chokes. And it doesn't matter whether the chokes are gi or no gi. There are certain principles and concepts you need to know in order to deal with them. Same thing with protecting yourself from arm bars, same thing with being able to pass guard or to recover guard. You know, there are certain principles, general principles that you need to know. Now, these are relatively universal, meaning we're not special in that we're the only ones that know it. No, every legitimate black belt knows these things. Now, the question is, how do they teach it? Do they just kind of say, hey, you know, just keep coming to class and you'll figure it out? Or do they actually have a plan? But what was that? There's a saying that the most guaranteed way to fail is to not have a plan. And jiu-jitsu is no different in that regard. You need to have a plan. So if you don't have a school guiding you, if your instructor is not guiding you, if he doesn't give you a framework to work off of, find your own framework. And what I would suggest is use the school you're at as your training ground and practice what you're going over in the curriculum and the methodology that you're going over in your free time. This way, you'll be able to hone your skills, but you need to be disciplined. Since you have no instructor there to really focus you, you're gonna need to focus yourself. But if you have a manual, so to speak, to go off of, it's much easier. And really, make jiu-jitsu easy. Don't make it difficult. Don't ask a million different questions. Don't ask, well, what if this happens? What if this happens? What if this happens? Learn the basics first. Don't worry about the what ifs. The basics will cover you for most incidences. Not all, right? But what we try to do is we try to be too close to perfect in the beginning. We try to cover too many different instances. Well, what if he punches you this way? What if he kicks you this way? What if he kicks you and punches you? What if he does a 1-2-3 combination? What if he does a 1-2-3 combo then a shoot? What if he does a 1-2-3 combo low single shoot? You know, it'll blow your mind. And you'll never learn it because it gets to be too overwhelming. Now, believe me, I went through this when jiu-jitsu was transitioning in the 2000 to 2010 timeframe, when the sport stuff was starting to come into prominence in the United States. Because when I started, there were no real competitions. You know, Joe Moreira had one every year, maybe. And I think we had the Pan Ams, and that's it. You know, we might have had one competition every 6 months if we were lucky in Southern California. But as it became more prolific, as more Brazilian black belts started to move to the U.S. and started to, you know, try to ride the wave of popularity of jiu-jitsu in the United States, then for them to make a name for themselves, they would compete and they would have students compete on their behalf and win, right? And that would then make it to where that would end up making sport jiu-jitsu kind of like the prominent style, because you actually had real world evidence of their efficacy. Well, that wave that came in brought in a bunch of new concepts into jiu-jitsu. You know, never before were we doing lapel chokes and using the lapels to tie people up so they can't move. And then, you know, it's stuff that we didn't really do in the old school Gracie jiu-jitsu. you know, all the fancy ways to grip, all the different ways to grip, we never really did. You know, a lot of the advanced open guard games, you know, inversions, de la Hivas, and all that, we really didn't have it, you know, before the advent of competition jiu-jitsu. So what happened for me was I looked at the totality of what jiu-jitsu was becoming, and I just thought, holy crap, you know, I'm never going to learn everything. I'm not even going to learn 50% of everything. What I ended up doing was seeing, I think I saw a match with Hiron Gracie years ago. I think he was a brown belt or something. And it was a match that kind of made me realize that, you know, here's a person who is known to have been kind of sequestered from the world. You know, a lot of people would say, you know, the you know, Horian's sons are being they're being disserved by their father because they're not being exposed to the modern jiu-jitsu concepts that are out. And I saw a match with him with another gentleman who is a world champion today, and they were both brown belts. And here's a guy who was being circulated around, being trained by, you know, a family member, and who was spectacular. And Hiron and him went together, and it was a great match, but at the end of the day, Hiron submitted him, choked him out. And I realized, wait a minute, you know, here's a guy who, he did nothing that I've never seen before, all basics. Pass the guard, you know, base, pass the guard, knee on belly, mount, choke. You know, regular cross-collar choke. And I thought to myself, wait a minute, he was able to successfully use his jiu-jitsu that he was taught, that I was taught, to be able to beat somebody who was a very hyped up competitor, very successful in his own right. You know, and then there's another time, I think, when Hiron and Henner were like 18 and 19 years old, and they were entered in some competition. And I remember Henner being put up against a very prominent black belt at the time, Brasileiro champion or whatever it was. I don't know if they had the Mundials at the time, but, you know, whatever the equivalent was of the world championships, this guy had won it. And Hiron, I think he footlocked him inside of a minute, finished him, guy, you know, made him tap. And I realized, wait a minute, at the end of the day, good jiu-jitsu is good jiu-jitsu. It's not, you know, do you have another tool? It's how well you use the tools that you use. But there are tools that are bigger tools than others. You know, some tools are very fine tools, and they're meant for very specific situations. And there are other tools that are more general tools. And the basics, the fundamentals of jiu-jitsu are those larger tools that are more useful in a lot of situations. Now, you know, let's say that they're useful in 85% of all situations. What I'm trying to get you to do is find a way to get yourself to first concentrate on those situations that get you to that first 85%. Don't even look at the remaining 15% until much later on. As I tell our students, when you're deep in the purple belt, then start exploring those options. But until then, worry about the 85%. Right? I did a video on this a while back. It was need to know versus good to know. That 85% is your need to know. The remaining 15% is good to know. It's not that you shouldn't know it. It's good to know it, but you want to know it after you know and you have digested the need to know concepts. So simple stuff, basic arm bar, basic choke, basic shoulder locks, basic foot locks, you know, getting out, you know, defense, getting, climbing that ladder, getting from underneath mount to guard to on top, you know, mount and then to submission, right? And everything in between. If you look at your jiu-jitsu that way, you know, if your curriculum helps you break it down in a way that makes it easy for you to learn, you will not only get really good really fast, you will love the ride while you're doing it. It is spectacular when you see how well you do. It's not rocket science, guys. Don't make it be complicated. Anyway, I hope that helps you guys. If you like this video, please go ahead and like it for us. It really helps us with the algorithms. And if you haven't subscribed to the channel, go ahead and subscribe and click that bell. And please visit us at KamaJiu-JitsuOnline.com or visit us in the Apple App Store or the Google Play Store, Kama Jiu-Jitsu Online. That's all I got for you. Take care. Happy training. Bye now.